Today's service is titled, Your Beloved Community Don't Look Like Mine. King envisioned the beloved community as a society based on justice, equal opportunity, and love of one's fellow human beings. Yet underserved communities and people of color must first rebuild in order to even begin to imagine a beloved community for themselves where justice, equality, and love for all can be a reality. This is where our conversation begins today. In a general comparison between King and Malcolm's vision of community. For the purposes of this comparison, we will say that what makes up a community is a shared identity, shared purpose, common objectives, shared interests, and shared behavior. Coretta Scott King said, "I think Martin and Malcolm agreed in terms of the ultimate goal of the freedom struggle. I don't think there was any difference there. I think it was basically one of strategy. My husband believed that to accomplish the goals of freedom and justice and equality, it was necessary to use nonviolent means, particularly in a society such as ours, where we were 10% of the population. And he believed that finally, nonviolence was the only alternative that oppressed people had in this kind of society. I think that Malcolm felt that people had a right to use any means necessary, even violence, to achieve goals of their freedom. I think that was the basic difference. Martin, I don't think, ever spoke publicly against Malcolm in any form. I think Malcolm did against Martin, unfortunately. But Martin never held that against him. I think they respected each other. I know Martin had the greatest respect for Malcolm, and he agreed with him in terms of feelings of racial pride and the fact that black people should believe in themselves and see themselves as lovable and beautiful. Martin had a strong feeling of connectedness to Africa, and so did Malcolm. I think that if Malcolm had lived, at some point, the two would have come closer together and would have been a very strong force in the total struggle for liberation and self-determination of black people in our society. Well, I think that sounds nice. But my research says Malcolm X and Martin Luther King Jr. met in person one time, ever. Two powerhouses fighting for the ultimate goal of the freedom struggle. And y'all ain't have time to cross paths more than once. If I were on a free and responsible search for truth and meaning, I would say something smells fishy. Something ain't adding up. The last thing changes these two could have made had they merged their influence and ideals. And the unknown reasons why they never did. If I had to play devil's advocate, I'd raise the question of if Martin Luther King Jr. was ever really for the freedom struggle. Or was he being used by an even higher power to keep those struggling in line and deter them from ruffling any feathers? Maybe this was an old switcheroo, like the King James rewrite of the Bible. To keep those enslaved and oppressed, believing that obedience was the only way to prevail. I don't mean to try to upset you. I raise these questions to challenge you, make you reconsider all you thought you knew about your black heroes on this last week of Black History Month, and force you to draw your own conclusions. Because I'm for the truth, no matter who tells it. I'm for justice. No matter who is for or against. I believe both Malcolm X and Martin Luther King Jr. changed the world in their own ways. Not more of a fan of either, really. I resonate a lot more with Malcolm, but I perceive him like I perceive men in my community today. Malcolm was a smart brother. Dropped out of school off of principle because his teacher told him he needed to pursue being a carpenter and that being a lawyer wasn't a reality for him. He figured out life a lot on his own and got into trouble with the law. He devoted himself to his faith, got married, was a family man, and fought for a cause that was worth his life. Men in my community remind me of Malcolm X. They're not gonna let you treat them any type of way. They're not gonna allow you to disrespect their women. Their name is worth more than its weight in gold, and time again, they have given their life for what they believe. Martin, in all his amazing ways, he just ain't like the brothers I grew up with. Martin graduated high school at 15 years old. At 19, he had his bachelor's, 22 a theology degree, and his PhD at 26. I don't know anyone like this in my community. If his CV came across my desk, I would double check it no matter what race was checked off. The man was simply amazing. And if I'm being real, I can see why he was the poster child for civil rights movement. People have dreams all the time. That don't make it a reality. We can wish and hope for a lot of things. But in order to achieve our goal of world community with peace, liberty, and justice for all, we gotta be real. Martin's beloved community ain't look like mine. That don't make his community worse or better. Just different. I just can't relate as well. When I was growing up, I was taught somebody hit you, you hit them back. My parents never subscribed to the tell the teacher and let her deal with it notion. Not to say one is better than the other, but people choose what works best for them. And that's important. It's very important that we try to understand what things work for different people in different communities before we pursue a beloved community for all. The community in the 1960s was not beloved. And though some changes have been made, it's still not beloved now. By definition of a shared identity, shared purpose, common objective, shared interests, and common behavior, it was still a community though, regardless of it being beloved or not. We don't even have that today. Not in the black community. Not like in the 1960s. Back then, we fought to be integrated because separate but equal wasn't equal at all. But now we are separated and unequal in our own race. All of us black, but some of us educated, some financially stable, some on Section 8, some scam, hustle, steal, deal, some presidents, vice presidents, superheroes. Some from the US, some from the Caribbean. Some want to be called black. Some prefer Bahamian or Jamaican or Haitian because they don't want to be associated with those other blacks. We all black, but not a community for a ton of reasons. Yeah, some are external, but still a lot internal. Still a lot of work we need to do from the inside out. Because blacks lack a shared identity, still in 2021, I'm in situations where I have to prove my blackness, where I have to convince someone else who is black that I too am black, even though they may perceive me as less black than them. Most blacks ought to know that no one is out here claiming to be black just because. Well, it was that one lady and, okay, well, let's just say if they are, it's not a common occurrence. These distinctions we make amongst ourselves because of light skin and dark skin and good hair and bad hair only separate us into these separate and unequal categories. Then we go out into the world and get categorized all over again. But this time, not just by people who look like us, but by everyone else. The black community specifically is weak from the inside out. Other communities are as well, but today, the black community is the focus. Within the black community, there is layered issues of segregation, education, incarceration, and a lot of other Asians that need help. We know this. We as a whole, as everyone, we get it, right? We know that blacks were enslaved and never gave reparations. We know that before the race even started, the blacks were several miles behind. We get it. But do we though? Because if we did, it wouldn't be a debate over what services the black bank offered compared to another bank, or how nice the dorms were at the historically black college versus the predominantly white college. If we really understood this, it would go without saying that black businesses and schools are not afforded the same opportunities as competing institutions, and therefore can't offer the same exact things. But that don't make them worse. Oh no, 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 my friends. That don't make them worse. They may be less competitive. They may not have all the same services, and the dorms may be older than your parents, but believe you me, what they do have, every service that they do offer, every class that they do teach, it's more than worth it. Point blank, period. Even if you needed to get two accounts or to dual enroll, if you understood this dynamic, you would support these businesses and these schools for the culture, not just for that business or school or whatever needs you needed from it. It's for all blacks everywhere. We say we get it, but when it comes down to it, we treat it like it's a disabled running partner. Not someone like high functioning who could run just like everybody else, but someone disabled who's gonna have some type of struggle or something that impedes them from being as fast and as quick as everybody else. We say to a person with a physical ailment that force their partner to be slower. If you're the running partner, you're saying, gosh, I wish this guy would pick up the pace. And if you're the disabled running partner, you're saying, this idiot doesn't know I'm disabled. I'm not gonna go no faster than this. In this analogy, the blacks are the disabled running partners. And we over here saying we get it, but then we steady asking them to speed up. We gotta be real, man. Cause it's a hard knock life for us. It's a hard knock life for us. Instead of treated, we've been tricked. Instead of kisses, we've been kicked. Education in the black community does not just begin and end with school. As a result of not having common objectives, shared interests, and common behavior in finances and healthcare, oftentimes many blacks are left to figure things out on their own best way they can, even if they are educated. That's why blacks have continued to die at an alarmingly high rate due to COVID-19. If it's not a predisposed issue, then it's nutrition or access to healthcare. And even though health-wise it takes shape differently, this is still a primary result of lack of education. I'll use myself to show you firsthand an account of how we are left to fend for ourselves, even when we are educated. Back on October 22nd of 2020, I joined Robinhood. It's a stock brokerage app on your phone. You've probably seen it in the news recently. A whole bunch of drama is circulating the company now, but I mentioned my experience with Robinhood to give you a real life example of what it means to be black. This affects more than just blacks, but I'm talking about the effects on black people in investing today. From October 22nd, 2020 to January 2021, I made $18,000 on Robinhood. Over that time, I invested about $7,500 on the app. And as I made profits, I took money back out. In January at the time, I was at $18,000. I had only about $2,700 of my own money in the market. And then the whole GameStop bubble happened, and well, you know the rest. I made my $2,700 back this week, and I sold all my options in stock. Can anyone guess why? I'm gonna make this a question in the chat. I wanna see what you guys come up with, and Chris is gonna bring the computer up here so I can see what people are, thank you, Chris, what people are coming up with. Let's see what you guys got. What you guys got? Is this a delay? I don't see anybody saying something. I'm trying to see what is your responses to your guess of why I got off of Robinhood. Too risky, time to get out. Okay, let's see what somebody else says. Because it's all about money to the bigger companies. The risk of the company going under would have impeded on your money. Okay, good guesses. Afraid to lose the money you actually work for. Okay, it's a lot like a casino, except in the long run. All right, we got some people jumping in. All good. Good things. The risk of profit will be lost. All right, all sensible things. Things that make sense. None the reason why I got off of Robinhood, but I'm gonna share that with you right now. I got off of Robinhood because in 3 months of basically educated gambling, I had found no reliable source to teach me about the market. No friends or family had knowledge. No people from work knew much that could help me. I even searched for a paid course to teach me about the market, and I couldn't find one. I'm still trying to figure out how people even learn the market. Do they teach people when they get a job at the brokerage? Where is this information at? I'm educated. I work in a city with nothing but millionaires and billionaires, and I can't seem to find this top secret information. And if you haven't figured it out yet, my friends, the stock market, like education and tons of other opportunities, are designed that way. To keep those in the know in and those out of the know out. We UUs understand the inherent worth and dignity of every person. And here in this issue, we want to search for a solution for justice, equality, and compassion in human relations in the Black community. I'm here to tell you, you can't. Or at least you can't in the way that you think you can. I say the Black community is broken from the inside out because, like an actual internal injury, it has to be healed inside out. There is no band-aids or ointments for internal injuries. What heals internal injuries, people? We're gonna go back to the chat. I know before maybe I caught everybody off guard. I'm telling people to write in the messages, and they're paying attention. They're like, wait, I'm supposed to write to you? Yes, you're supposed to write to me. This is how we keep our community thing going over the internet. We write back to each other, then I can talk about it, and then we all feel apart. So I'm gonna give you guys some time. I know it's a little bit of a delay, but write in the chat, what heals internal injuries? Rest and good nutrition. Yeah, that's true. Time. What an answer. We gave the answer now, but let's see what other people pull up. Yeah, time. time. We can search out solutions, our efforts can affect change, but we need a bunch of time. Like an internal injury, there is no quick fix to getting the Black community on track. See, emancipation ruined Black education and created poverty in the Black community. In Carter G. Woodson's book, The Miseducation of the Negro, he states, "The poverty which afflicted them for a generation after emancipation held them down to the lowest order of society, nominally free, but economically enslaved." I'm sure if the truth was presented, no one would have chosen this. What would you rather? Be enslaved, do what I say, and live a decent life? Or be free, be so poor you can't do anything, and be hungry? I'm going with enslaved for 500. Emancipation was a setup, and we ain't even know it. I know talking about the 60s may seem like a long time ago, but a guy who just recently retired was hired after a lawsuit 20 years ago on Miami Beach, where they were forced to hire a handful of Black officers after losing a discrimination lawsuit. A friend of mine showed me her grandmother's ID that allowed her access to Miami Beach when it was a white-only beach. Her grandma. So yeah, this is more recent than sometimes we give it credit. I know a beloved community is possible because I have grown up watching the fierce LGBTQ plus community take the world by storm. Even though each letter of the acronym represents a different category of people or sexual preference, as a whole, they still maintain a shared identity, a shared purpose, common objective, shared interests, and common behavior. So it's possible. But if we can't do it with politics, how will we ever do it with race? In a book titled A Rising Nation by Kajara Nebith, it states, a lady once told me that she thought Puff Daddy Sean Combs was a great leader because he was wealthy and influential. Many young people grow up with celebrities as their leaders and role models because they lack positive, wealthy, influential people in their realm to look up to or be guided by. Priests are spiritual leaders who at one time were rulers and kings, queens, advisors, educators, and more. They were also known to be influential in the community around them. Today, the pastors of the church are also leaders, yet many fail to uphold the morals and integrity that they preach about to others. We have an opportunity now to create a movement or migration of people from the church to traditional spiritual systems. People are becoming conscious and ready to learn the truth because there is much more information available with technology than ever before. If we do so in a righteous way, we can create the communities we desire and deserve. Everything starts with spirit, and with spirit and with strong spiritual foundation, we can heal, grow, and build exactly what we need for the next generations to come. I know the majority of the service has been heavy, but here is the pick-me-up part. We are on our way. As a congregation, as Unitarian Universalists, as a people who see an issue and are addressing it head on, we are moving on up to the east side. We ain't got that pie yet, but that's okay. Some things that we have established will take root and create change. Some things will eventually phase out. But as we take our time and have these conversations and share thoughts and ideals of a better, more beloved community, we will in time find more and more solutions. In widening the circle of concern, the report of the UUA Commission on Institutional Change, which if you have not gotten a copy, I strongly suggest, it states, in spite of the promise of our movement, we still need to address the biases and oppression within our systems to build resilience and our living tradition for the times we are in and strengthen it for future generations. This is the most important line in the book. It's basically saying faith without works is dead. I'm going to read it again. In spite of the promise of our movement, we still need to address the biases and oppressions within our systems to build resilience in our living tradition for the times we are in and strengthen it for future generations. We got to practice what we preach, y'all. And we are. And we will continue to. And I am proud of that. Now, I can't wait until white privilege apologies phase out. They started off almost complimentary, like how you would say, excuse me, when having to pass someone in a seated row, like, excuse me, pardon me, coming through. But after a while, people get desensitized to what they're saying. Could you imagine me apologizing for my black skin, like mid-conversation, just randomly in a conversation? You know, it would be a bit weird, right? That's how weird it is when people start apologizing to others for their privilege. I'm happy that people are aware of it, don't get me wrong. The awareness is essential, but the apology is just weird. On a positive note, a lot of bad things are phasing out of the black community and is already showing major progress. For example, no longer is it a trend for blacks to be the first generation in college in their house, or not to be credit savvy, or think cash is king, or be afraid to make investments or buy property or travel, try something new or do something different. This generation of the black community is a different breed and is making changes across the board. A clear leader still has not risen, but in due time, we will get one. We live and we learn as we utilize our efforts. Over time, we will begin to see even bigger changes in the black community. But we all share an equal part in this responsibility. It is not only the blacks that need to work to fix the black community, it is everyone. And not just because someone or some people took part in inflicting the injuries of the black community, but because we as a larger community, as human beings, are only as strong as our weakest link. The black community and all underserved populations need 360 support in order to have a fighting chance. Highlighting that your beloved community don't look like mine shows the differences that make up who we are and how acknowledging these differences is the first step in creating a beloved community for all. You could have heard this service and thought the whole time this was merely about black and white, but you would be oh so wrong. Black and white was a recurring theme, but this story was a classic tale of an underdog, the person everyone has counted out, the one everyone is betting against, the person who has all the hurdles in their way, but somehow, some way, a little bitty mustard seed pops out of nowhere. And you're watching the fight thinking, this guy ought to just tap out. He is done. He is glutton for punishment. But he gets back up. And you're saying, they should call the fight. This guy gonna get hurt. But he's still hanging in there. And it takes a second for that underdog to catch his balance. Oh, but when he does, the other guy's in trouble. More trouble than he expected. Slowly but surely, the underdog's killer instincts come out and in time, and blow for blow, the once underdog on the ropes fights his way to the championship of the world. Because you can't lose a fight you don't quit. Don't matter if you down right now. All that really matters is that you don't give up. That we don't give up. As Black History Month comes to a close, spend the rest of this week thinking of what communities you're a part of. Who do you have a shared identity with? A shared purpose with? Common objectives? Shared interests and a common behavior with? What things can you take from your personal community experiences that can contribute to the Black community? We don't have to reinvent the wheel. We just need to get the wheel rolling for everyone.